May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Please be seated. Well, good morning. It's lovely to be back with you. I was trying to remember what year it was. I was here for several months and got to know so many of you and began to say as I came in, good morning, the lovely choir. Good day. Well, I have not actually in my life thought very much about salt, but today's gospel immediately made me think of my little granddaughter, Willa, who is 5, who loves to go to the dining room table and take the salt shaker and open it up and put some salt in her hand and start to lick it. And her grandmother says, Willa, and she says, but I like it. She's awfully cute. When I was that age, I loved the label on the Morton salt container. And you all know this, right? There's a little girl, she has an umbrella, and you know, it's that dark blue cylindrical shape, right? And she's holding the salt, and it's leaking out behind her. And the label says, you all know what it says, when it rains, it pours, is what it says, which I used to think, huh, when I was a kid. But it turns out that it refers to the fact that Morton's figured out some chemical to add to the salt so it would not clump in humid weather, which was an amazing discovery. And actually, there's been some version of that same label since 1914, a long time. And actually, Morton's is the only salt that I had in our kitchen until about 10 years ago. And then suddenly recipes started calling for something called, somebody's laughing over here, sea salt or kosher salt. And I kind of went, huh? And then one Christmas, our daughter Sarah sent me some chocolates, which I love. And then, lo and behold, big chunks of salt on top of the chocolate. And my, did that taste good. I still like that. So if you read up about salt on the internet, which of course I did, you will find a lot of information. Did you know, probably you did, that sometimes salt is mined, and sometimes it's harvested from salt water, which is left to sit in the sun and the wind until it evaporates the water and it becomes salt. Salt that can be used. And it turns out there are an amazing variety of salts. Just look on the internet if you have nothing better to do. You can actually join a kind of a salt club, like a wine club, that offers 100 flavors with suggestions about how to use them, but unfortunately not how to store 100 flavors of salt. And what was I going to say? Let's see, salt can be beautiful too. You can see pictures of chunks of Himalayan pink salt, really pretty. And there's something called Kala Namak, also from the Himalayas, which is salt which has been mixed with, get this, charcoal, herbs, seeds, and bark, and fired in a furnace for 24 hours, and then stored and aged. And there is black, this is, we're almost done with this recitation. There is black lava salt, which is harvested from volcanoes in Hawaii, who knew, which also has red salt. Of course, most salt is white, but you can bet not much of it looks like good old Morton salt. Well, it turns out salt was important in biblical times as well. It could be used as a seasoning, for preservation, for disinfectant. I didn't know this. It was actually used as a unit of exchange at some points, and sometimes even as sacrifice in the Old Testament. So what is it today Jesus says to his followers that put me in this mind? He says, you are the salt of the earth, but if salt has lost its taste, can its saltiness be restored? And I read that and I went, uh-oh, has my salt somehow been diminished or even lost its taste? And really, you know, how would I know? And if so, what should I do? And like so many passages, are we being bidden to try harder, to do more, to give more somehow? be more. And then I notice that Jesus doesn't say, be more salty. He says, you are the salt of the earth. Friends, we already are. We already are. And can it be that we are enough just as God created us? If we give it our best, maybe that's enough. So isn't it true that sometimes we feel saltier than others? That was true for me. I remember with great joy those heady days when I was, found myself in a radical spiritual journey, and my life was suddenly filled with all these new things, with Bible study and ardent prayer and new ministries. And I remember, dear people, administering the chalice for the first time at St. Mary's, and when I looked up and saw people coming forward to receive, every single head was surrounded by light. Every single head was shining with goodness. And I remember God coming to me right there in the working sacristy at St. Mary's and calling me to ordination. And the early days of being a priest, when I used to say, you know what, they pay me to do this. And you know, sometimes I miss those days now that I'm retired and a little gimpy and can't do two services in a row. And I kind of miss those days, and I miss that feeling. And I bet a lot of you know exactly what I mean, that you have had, or maybe now are having, and wouldn't that be great, a time of spiritual, powerful spiritual awareness. Maybe because I know this community bit, maybe you're thinking a little bit of Curcio and how fabulous and stirring and inspiring that was. And the joy and energy of all that. Or maybe it's you're thinking about a decision to be baptized or be confirmed. Yeah, so it turns out that we can't live in those what I call mountaintop experiences all the time. When Jesus says, you are the salt of the earth, I don't think, actually, he's calling us to more self-exertion. I think he's reminding us to be ourselves, our own inimitable selves, whom he created, in living out our promise to be good disciples, day in, day out, day by day. And it's actually fun to think about the variety of people in the Bible who serve God in so many different ways. So many salty people. So the first one who comes to my mind is John the Baptist, who was so different than Jesus that he actually, do you remember this? He actually sends his disciples when he's in prison. He sends his disciples to Jesus to say, are you the one who is to come, or is there another? Because, you know, John was expecting fire and winnowing forks. Boy, he was very salty. But Jesus' salt, that came with healing and teaching and showing people a new way. And I think of wonderful Joseph in the Old Testament, surviving his brother's betrayal to become Pharaoh's right-hand man, savior of a remnant of Israel. And Moses, my goodness, talk about salty. Moses parting the Red Sea and leading the people through the desert for 40 years. Oh, and I think of the women at Jesus' tomb. And I think of Peter, who was always doing impetuous things like just jumping in the water and trying to walk across it, and who actually betrayed Jesus, didn't he? And then forgave himself and went on to become the rock of the church. And we know that our beloved pastor Linda is studying Paul right now, speaking of salty people, who went all over the Mediterranean to spread the word of Jesus. Each of these people is so different, and each is so vital to bringing about the kingdom of God here on earth. And I look out at each one of you, each one of you, dear people, laboring in Jesus' vineyard, also very different as one table salt and pink Himalayan salt, as different as kosher salt and black volcanic salt, all of us, each one of us, being God's hands and hearts in this wonderful world, all of us letting our lights shine. Well, dear salty and shining people, you are the salt, you are the light, and so may you be blessed and may you be a blessing today and always. Amen.